Welcome to worship with Celebration Community Church. I am Doreen Taylor Swift. I'm the pastor of Celebration. This is Pentecost Sunday. It is the birthday of the church. It is the day that the Spirit came like flames of fire upon the disciples, came to remind the church of its call to be inclusive, generous, and loving. Tonight at 6 p.m. is our drive-in communion. There were instructions in my letter that you received earlier this week, and instructions sent to you that will tell you exactly how to come in and get your elements and then go to the parking lot. Even though we have to wear masks and stay in our cars, we will get to see each other from afar. Hear these words from Janet Morley. Flame, dancing spirit, come. Sweep us off our feet and dance us through our days. Surprise us with your rhythms. Dare us to try new steps. Explore new patterns and new partnerships. Release us from old routines to swing in abandoned joy and fearful adventure. And in the intervals, rest us in your still center. Amen.
Holy Spirit, presence of God, holy breath, life divine, holy wind, mover, shaker, we throw open our hearts before you. We cast down every barrier to your freedom. We yield to your boundless nature. We welcome your wildness.
Too long have we tried to tame the wind. Too long have we sought to control what's wild. Too long have we stood in domination over the earth. At this moment of earth's great groaning, yearning, as if in labor, to birth what's holy and enduring, come, breathe, blow, move upon us all.
That earth and all that's in it may thrive, that earth and all that's in it may love, that earth and all that's in it may live, in harmony and wholeness you desire for us and all creation. Come, Great Spirit,
breathe, blow, move upon us.
Here now, may it be so.
Come, Holy Spirit, the one who sang a new melody as God's creation rose from chaos, who wept at the dark shadow of a cross, and who danced early in the morning at the opening of an empty tomb. Come, Holy Spirit, the one who could not be contained by wind or flame or breath, the one who blesses the church with courage, peace, and love. Come, Holy Spirit, to us, who gather this day with trembling hands and uncertain hearts. Teach us to sing a new song and to dance with reckless abandon. Here in the gathering of believers, as you did with those so long ago, breathe on us now. Breathe on us, blowing away your fears and your hesitations. Breathe on us, transforming your heartedness into passion-filled lives. Breathe on us, for we need peace, peace that only you can give. In Jesus' name, amen. A reading from Psalms. O Lord, how manifold are your works! In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in the works of the Lord, who looks on the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to God, for I rejoice in the Lord. Bless thee, O Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord.
On each face. Without a doubt we'll know that we have been revived when we
Please pray with me. Creator God, we give you thanks for the many ways you show us who you are. You come to us unseen like the wind. You illuminate the world around us like the dawn. You grant us a new beginning every day. You warm and comfort us. You give us courage and fire and strength. Help us listen, O God, and pay attention so we will not miss your presence. Open our hearts and minds to new ways of experiencing you. Thank you for being with us and with all who need peace and healing today. We pray especially for Al Espinoza, Alice Mooneyham, Bill Elliott, Bill Jemison, Carol West, Chuck Drake, Cindy Roden, Del Boyette, Debbie Peralt, Kathy Ferguson, Di Sharp, Eric Sterling, Glenda Gardner, Joanne Peters, Julie Minshew, Laura Davis, Richard Hernandez, Robin Collier, Sonia Kilgo, Jim and Pat Young, Aline, April, Betsy, Brandy, Carla, Carlton, Kathy, Christy, Cynthia, Dan, Darlene, David, Jane, Dean, Desiree, Diane, Dorothy, Elaine, Gary, Gwen, Janie, Jerry, John, Paige, Chris, Lorena, Jack, Lorraine, Margaret, Martha, Maxine, Mike, Oscar, Renee, Paulette, Stacy, Suzanne, Vicky, Willie, Yolanda, family and friends of Pamela Hand. We pray for our healthcare workers and first responders. We pray for all those who are incarcerated and especially those directly affected by the increase in domestic violence and child abuse. Be with us, Holy Spirit, in all we say or think, in all we do, this day and every day. Amen.
Acts, 2nd chapter, 1 through 21. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one of them heard speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, staying with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who have lived in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will show portents of the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood, for the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Free.
When our son Stuart was born, I had to have an emergency C-section because he weighed almost 12 pounds and he was 24 inches long. That was many years ago, but it is an experience one never forgets. After something like that, I think a person deserves an Amazon Woman t-shirt, don't you? Lest I digress, one of my clearest memories of that day is what happened in ICU after Stuart was born. It was in Arkansas, and if you had surgery after 5 in the afternoon, you went to ICU for a while because surgical recovery closed at 5 p.m. ICU had a number of beds with only a curtain between each bed, so I could hear all the conversations between the medical personnel and other patients. One patient was from another country, and his interaction with the nurse went something like this. "You have had surgery." The patient replied in another language. The nurse tried again, a bit more slowly. "You have had surgery." The patient still did not understand, and again, he replied in his native language. Not to be deterred, the nurse then said very slowly, "You have had surgery." And of course, the patient still could not understand. We Americans sometimes think that if we only talk louder and slower, a person who speaks another language will suddenly understand. Unfortunately, it doesn't work that way. This is why we know something else is going on in the story of Pentecost, which is recorded by Luke in the book of Acts. When the Jews from all different countries had gathered in Jerusalem, they heard their native languages spoken by the Galileans, and they were amazed and perplexed. These Galileans were people who weren't likely to speak languages other than their native tongues. It was such an amazing occurrence that some of the Jews from other countries assumed that the Galileans were drunk. It isn't clear how being drunk would enable one to speak another language, so go figure. But Peter stands to preach, and he tells all who were present that none of the Galileans are drunk. "What is happening," Peter says, "is it is a fulfillment of an end-of-time prophecy, which is in the Old Testament book of Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men will dream dreams." What happened that day in Jerusalem is that the Spirit came upon the disciples like tongues of fire. They received power to proclaim their gospel message in the tongues of the diverse peoples gathered in Jerusalem. It was a miracle of epic proportions, and 3,000 people joined the church that very day. Because of the gift of the Spirit, the people heard the good news in their own language, unlike the gentleman in the ICU with me in Arkansas. In contrast to the uniformity of the Roman Empire. So this means that from the very beginning, the church is polylingual, diverse, and multi-ethnic. Pentecost connects this new revelation with the giving of the law to Moses on Mount Sinai. Pentecost is Greek for 50. So Pentecost is 50 days after Passover. Pentecost is one of the three major feast days on the Jewish calendar, and this is why so many Jews from other countries are visiting in Jerusalem. They are there to celebrate at the temple. Joan Killen writes, "Pentecost is what completes Easter. Without Pentecost, Easter would leave us in anguish, in loneliness. We would be sad at saying a farewell to a risen Christ who returns to God. Without Pentecost, we Jesus followers would be left bereft and orphaned in this world with nothing but fond memories of what once was. Well, without Pentecost, we, the body of Christ, the church, would be left to face the world unarmed and ill-equipped for the task given to us. with Pentecost, all that changes. Now, the Holy Spirit is usually described in one of two ways. One as a still small voice that whispers in our ears and moves deeply in our inner being, or as a holy hurricane, the untamable wind. Of course, it is really both. Because the Holy Spirit is a laughing, joyful, wild presence which swirls and blows, but she also whispers and comforts and nurtures. There is really nothing that we can do to make the Spirit appear except pray, "Come, Holy Spirit, come." In these days of COVID-19, we are dependent on both manifestations of the Spirit. There are so many days when we need that still small voice which can give us courage to take the next step. The still small voice that helps us take a step back and remember what is important. When we are overcome with anxiety and sadness, like this week when we heard that 100,000 people have now died of COVID-19. But on other days, we need the wild, loud manifestation of the Spirit. In the Celtic tradition, the Holy Spirit is represented as a wild goose. Now, this idea comes from the island of Iona off the western coast of Scotland. Wild geese are untamed and uncontrolled, and they make a lot of noise. They are reminders that when it comes to God, we should expect the unexpected. At Pentecost, the Spirit came upon those gathered like a wild, noisy goose. Through the years when theology and God seemed to be under the control of religious institutions and religious people, the Spirit of God has broken free. Whenever the church has become complacent, Spirit-filled people have warned of the dangers of believing that the gospel can be contained and controlled. The spirit goose is insistent on renewal and change, on justice and truth. Those upon whom the Spirit rests are forced by the Spirit to become like wild geese, noisy, passionate, courageous advocates of the gospel's radical demands. The wild geese share the leadership of the flock. They help each other. When a wild goose is wounded, two others follow it to help and protect it. The Spirit is like that, for it never gives up on any of God's children. It never gives up on the world or the church. The good news of the gospel is to be heard and understood by everyone. Now, some would say that the story of Pentecost begins centuries before with the story of the Tower of Babel. God created the human community to live in peace and harmony with God and one another. But the people gathered together and decided that they would build a city and a tower that would go high into the heavens. They did not want to be dispersed, and they thought that by building a city with a high, high wall, they could protect themselves and their culture. Because, of course, they believed that they were God's favorites. They wanted only people who looked like them, who were just like them, who worshiped in the same way, because they thought everyone knows that our way is God's way. Won't it be cozy, comfortable, and secure? John Buchanan says they wanted life in a big gated community with their own kind of people, all the same, safe, and secure. God's response to that? "I'm not having anything to do with this. Sameness is not for me," God says. So God comes down, stirs the pot, causes people to speak different languages, and then scatters them all over the face of the earth. God loves diversity. God's creation is full of differences and contrasts, different languages, different races, different cultures, different cultural institutions, and even different religions. And then comes after Jesus' ascension, Pentecost, when the wild, untamed Holy Spirit arrives, and suddenly the disciples are preaching in the languages of all those who are there. Now, this is not the same as speaking in tongues or glossolalia, which is usually not understood by people who are present. Speaking in tongues is often associated with Pentecostal churches. But what happened at Pentecost is the opposite of this, because there the disciples were speaking in other languages and people could hear and understand the gospel. The message of Pentecost is that God wants diversity. God likes diversity. God wants us to be inclusive, generous, and loving people. God seems to want a church full of all different kinds of people. So as the church, we should be leading the way. We should be showing the world how we can live together in love. It doesn't mean everybody being the same or even that we have to agree, but that we live together respecting each person as a child of God. But we forget so easily. We get comfortable. It's just easier to be church with people like ourselves because we know we are God's favorite people, right? In the news this week, there were two stories that I think made God cry. Two stories. There may have been more, but these two made me imagine God listening to the news on television. And when God hears these stories, God shakes God's head and says, "Where did I go wrong? I thought they understood." The first was the incident in Central Park with a man in a section of the park where there are many different kinds of birds. In that section of the park, dog walkers are supposed to put their dogs on a leash so that the dogs won't chase and catch the birds. The man's name is Christian Cooper, and he is on the board of the Audubon Society in New York City. He is the gay Harvard-educated science editor, and he is known in comic circles as the man behind the gay Star Trek character of Yoshi Mishima. He sees a woman with a dog off-leash coming towards him. He asks her if she would please put her dog on its leash. She refuses. So he began a video on his cell phone of her dog running loose. She then starts telling him to stop recording her, and he says, "Just put your dog on its leash." And she begins telling him that if he doesn't quit filming her, she is going to call the police and tell them that an African-American man is threatening her life. The man says calmly, "That's a good idea. Call the police." She repeats her threat, and then she does call the police. And when they answer, she suddenly becomes hysterical and shouts, "There is an African-American man threatening me. Send the police immediately." It's shocking that she would not just respond, "Sure, I'll put my dog on a leash," or, "No, I'm not going to put my dog on a leash." Instead, she went right to making it a matter of race. Now, the second story is the most disturbing. What we have seen of this story is that the police are called to a forgery in progress. They handcuff a man named George Floyd, an African American who is unarmed. They begin to take him to their police car when suddenly, somehow, the man is lying in the street. It is difficult to tell what happened at that point. The next thing we see is a police officer with his knee on Mr. Floyd's neck, and then Mr. Floyd begins saying he can't breathe. Bystanders say to the police, "Can't you hear him? He can't breathe." The officer keeps his knee on George's neck for 8 minutes. George Floyd died after repeatedly telling the officer that he could not breathe. I urge you to read these stories for yourselves. In my mind, both of them pull a scab off the soul of our nation, and underneath, after all these years, racism is still festering in our souls. It seems that we haven't gotten very far at all. At Pentecost, the Spirit came to a diverse community, people from different places speaking many languages. It's so sad to think that racism is still such a problem in our country. Where is the church in all of this? How can the church be the church and speak out and offer love, inclusivity, and generosity? In thinking about these two stories, I then read an article by a woman who is a senior producer at CNN. She was writing about hearing George Floyd calling out "Mama" when he was pinned to the ground. She writes about how sweet that name is to her, especially since she is mama to her, as she writes, black son Drew. He's grown. He's quite accomplished in his own right. When she heard George Floyd in his final minutes scream, "Mama," she thought of Drew. Floyd's mother is deceased, but in his cry, she writes that she heard a twisted combination of hope and horror. Hope, because in that moment, he was asking for a person, the person who gave him life, to come and save his life, even though she is no longer living. She'd probably done it many times before. And in horror, because that's never how a black mama wants to hear her sacred title. Oglesby says she has heard that cry of mama so many times. She says when Floyd cried mama, she knew she couldn't help, but she was ready to go fight for him because he's someone's child and he needed someone with a mother's love to help him. Even though her son is grown, he knows and she knows that she is and will always be his mama. But then Oglesby goes on to say, "I'm tired. I'm tired of being scared for him. I'm tired of reading about Ahmaud, Travis, George, and so many others. The list never stops. I need the white mamas to share this burden. I need my white friends to love me and mine enough to come running too. I need them to hear that cry and to tell their sons and daughters that my child is human. I need them to declare and believe that he's in danger, that I can't protect him by myself, and that his life matters to me and to them. I need them to tell their white friends' children too, my child's life is sacred. My child is not dangerous. She says my baby calls me every time he's caught being black." Oglesby offers gratitude for one of her white friends, Stacy, who has loved her son Drew and been there for her and for him. She says Stacy never says, "I don't see color." She sees it because she truly sees me. She knows how it shapes the world that I see and how the world sees me. She knows my son and she authentically cares about him. She knows when I'm hurting without me having to tell her. So Stacy wrote Oglesby this note: "Thank you for raising a godly young man who makes the world a better place. I have been thinking about y'all with the Ahmaud Arbery horror going on. What a travesty that these things still happen and are still covered up, tolerated, swept under the rug. Excused in 2020 is heartbreaking. I thank God that you have had the sense to educate Drew to exercise extreme caution and always be aware of his surroundings. He is a treasure not just to you, but to all of us who know him. And I pray for his safety, happiness, and the fulfillment of God's purpose in his life. Love you both, Mama Stacy. Oglesby ends her article by writing, I can't stop hearing George Floyd's cry, Mama, Mama. Stacy hears it. I pray others will hear it too. Do you think the church hears that cry? At Pentecost, everyone heard that the church is for all people. Everyone worshiping together as the wild goose swirls and blows and moves among them, calling them to a new way of being, thinking, and doing. As a part of the church, our prayer is always, come, Holy Spirit, come. Help us. How can we do things differently? So that mamas don't have to teach their children that some people hate them, people who don't even know them. They hate them because they're black or brown or have different eyes or speak a different language. Are we willing to listen to the children who are calling, Mama, Daddy, Sister, Brother, help me? Soren Kierkegaard wrote a parable about geese, and this one is called The Tame Geese. In this story, he asks us to imagine that these geese could talk and think and do the kinds of things that we all do. The tame geese went to church every week. Each week, they were inspired by a powerful, motivating sermon by the high goose. The sermon always went the same. The high goose would tell the assembled geese of their high calling and destiny and about what a high goal the Creator had appointed for geese, for the Creator had given them wings. As he said all this, the geese would honk and squawk their approval. The geese curtsied and ganders bowed their heads in honor of the great words. With their wings, the high goose told them they could fly anywhere they wanted around the world. They were thrilled to hear this. And each week after church, as they dispersed, the geese would waddle home. We have wings, for goodness sakes. The wild goose spirit is calling us to stand up and be the church. Come, come, Holy Spirit. Do not give up on us. Let's be the church. Let's take wing and fly. Amen. Now is the time in the service when we would bring our offerings to the altar. We thank you for the ways that you are still bringing your offerings to the church, that you're still supporting the ministries and missions of Celebration. We are enabled to do some very caring and compassionate things in our community, helping people who have food insecurity, and it's all because of you and your willingness to be a part of God's mission in the world. And now we gather around God's table of inclusivity, of welcome and love. We gather to share the bread and the cup. On that night, before Jesus was arrested, he took bread, just ordinary bread. He blessed it, and then he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. It is the bread of life. It is my body." We eat together. And then Jesus took the cup and he said, "This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sin." Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, remember me. remember that I love you. And so we drink the cup of grace, the blood of Christ. Please pray with me. God, we give you thanks for these gifts. We pray that they will nourish us to be more courageous and bold in the world, more courageous and bold in sharing your love with all of God's children. Amen. As we think about these stories that have stirred our hearts and our consciences and made us sad, mad, hopefully they will spur us to do things that will make a difference. We do know that so many police officers are called to help people, and that's why they become police officers. And so we give thanks for them this day. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God give you the grace never to sell yourself short, the grace to risk something big for something good, the grace to know that the world is now too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. And so may God take your mind and think through it. May God take your voice and speak through it. And may God take your heart and set it on fire through Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen.